Defense Secretary Rumsfeld was on Capitol Hill today to talk about operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. He's joined by the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Richard Myers. This House Armed Services Committee hearing is about 2.5 hours.
Mr. Secretary, thank you for coming back and joining us to complete your testimony. And I just wanted to tell the committee, since my letter to the Washington Post was not printed, that following your last appearance here, the Post wrote an article that implied that somehow you'd gotten irritated and left. and that's not accurate. And I just want to tell the committee and the folks that read the Washington Post, which didn't print my letter, that you agreed we always get together before we have a hearing, lay out our time parameters, and you've always stuck with them. You've always generously given us all the time that you needed. And on that particular day, you had two hearings. And so you said, well, I'll come early and give the Armed Services guys on the House side plenty of time. And we said, you can't come early because we have conferences in our parties, and so we've got to start at 10 o'clock. And so we agreed to a hard stop at 1 o'clock, and at 1 o'clock, in fact, a little bit after 1, we gave you about 3 bites of a sandwich out of a box lunch in our ante room. You went out and answered 5 questions with the press and then went right over to your other hearing, as we had agreed to and planned. And we got an article in the Post that implied that, and stated essentially, that you had gotten irritated and left the committee. So I just wanted to set the record straight that you did precisely as we agreed to, and you offered to give us more time that day, and it was the committee which couldn't accommodate that because our members had to be at other conferences early on. So we're glad that you're back, and we guaranteed all of our members that they would have a chance to complete their questions. And that's what we're going to do today. So without lengthy ado, let me ask Mr. Skelton if he'd like to say anything, and then we'll just go right to our questions, and we'll keep on proceeding apace until every member of this now 62-member committee has a chance to ask a question. And thanks for being with us today. Appreciate it.
Thank you,
Mr.
sir.
Mr. Skelton.
Let me just thank you for coming back. It's certainly good if you give everyone the opportunity to ask you questions, and I know we had to cut it short the other day, so this will complete the round. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'm Dick Myers, and Tina Jonas and I are happy to be back. I did also note the confusion that was presented in the Washington Post, and I appreciate your very accurate explanation. I wonder if it'll appear in the Washington Post. Probably not, huh?
I don't think the reporter who wrote that article appeared in this hearing room on the day that we had this hearing.
Needless to say, just to be on the safe side today, I can stay as long as you need me here. I can't speak for General Myers or Tina, but first I'd like to take a moment. I have no prepared statement to present, but I would want to mention someone who epitomized every day the strength and goodness of our country, and who was highly respected and admired, our friend Tilly Fowler. As you know, she had been serving as the chairperson of our Defense Policy Board in recent time and doing so with great distinction. She was independent, she was smart, she was tough-minded, and she was always ready to serve her country and her community and to be as helpful as she could to the men and women in uniform. I know her contributions to this committee were important. Certainly they were important to our armed forces and to the Department of Defense, and they will be long-lasting. And those of us who counted on Tilly Fowler's counsel and wisdom feel her loss very deeply. So, Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I'll submit a few other remarks to the record, and we'll turn directly to questions.
Thank you, Ms. Secretary. And on that point, a number of us went down to Tilly's funeral in Florida, and I got a chance to spend a little time with Buck, her husband, and her two wonderful daughters. And Buck told a little story on Tilly and on you, and that he said she was called by you to work on one of these difficult issues and serve, head up a commission or serve on a commission. And he said, your question was, Tilly, do you know anybody? Could you give me some references on some people who might be good for this commission? And after she'd given you several, you said, would you mind serving on the commission? And she said, I was afraid you were going to get to that. And on that particular commission, she did. And the essence, I think, of our strength as a nation is people like Tilly who will come forward after their public service here on the Hill is over. Yeah. And I'm thinking also of Lee Hamilton doing a great job in this last bill that we did on Intel, and lots of other members who have come forward to work on issues of importance to our country, and sign up often in a way that inconveniences them personally. But Tilly, I think, epitomized that spirit, and she brought a lot of spirit to the process. So thank you. Let me tell our members, we're gonna start off with Mr. Schwartz. He was the next up, and let me go over the batting order here so members know where they're at. We've got Mr. Wilson of South Carolina, Mr. Langevin, Rhode Island, Mr. Cooper, Tennessee, Mr. Conaway, Texas, Mr. Marshall of Georgia, Mr. Klein, Minnesota, Ms. McKinney, Georgia, Mr. Miller, Michigan, or Ms. Miller, Michigan, Ms. Bordaio, Guam, Mr. Franks, Arizona, Mr. Butterfield, North Carolina. That's a start of the batting order. So let's go to Mr. Schwartz, a gentleman from Michigan and a new member of our committee, Mr. Schwartz.
Mr. Secretary, General Myers, thanks for coming back to the Armed Services Committee. I have two quick issues. The lesser one, perhaps, or the easier one first. Undersecretary Chu and Assistant Secretary Winkenwerder were happy. I don't know if they were happy enough, but they were kind enough to come into my office today and discuss TRICARE and the problems in the medical community, my medical community. Of provider acceptance of TRICARE, we agreed that there was not adequate acceptance, especially for the families of Guard and Reserve individuals who are on active duty in Iraq and Afghanistan and elsewhere around the world. While TRICARE may have some problems on the reimbursement side, I think they're small. TRICARE for active duty individuals and their families of active duty, and TRICARE for retirees, I think, is quite an excellent program. I have committed to Secretary Chu that I will write a letter to my state medical society. I have committed to Secretary Chu that I will try to get the other seven physicians in the House, at least as many who choose to sign, to write a letter to the American Medical Association and encourage them, irrespective of the situation and irrespective of payments right now, that they accept TRICARE for the dependents of reservists, mm-hmm. and guardsmen and women on active duty right now, and there's absolutely no reason not to. And Dr. Chu has committed to me to look at the question of reimbursement to make sure the administrative service contractor for TRICARE is doing the job that they should do. But I wanted you, Mr. Secretary, and you, General Myers, to know that as a physician, I'm aware of it, and that I believe it is the patriotic duty of every physician in this country to accept TRICARE for the dependents of those serving in Iraq and Afghanistan and elsewhere. That was a statement and not a question, but I wanted you to know that, Mr. Secretary.
Congressman, let me just say that is terrific. We really appreciate that initiative and effort on your part and your colleagues, and there's no question but that is exactly what is needed. Thank you.
My question has to do with replacing equipment in a military which has seen a lot of heavy duty in the last decade. And if you would just comment, Mr. Secretary, and or General Myers, on the job we have. We have a great force ready to go anywhere in the world. What is it going to take in the way of monetary investment? What's it going to take in the way of time to get our military equipped right up to where they ought to be for the next place, I guess I would have to say, that we're going to have to go, and we know that in the next decade or so we'll be somewhere with troops in significant numbers.
Congressman, thank you. You're correct that the equipment that the armed forces have, whether it's tanks or Bradley fighting vehicles or Strikers or aircraft, are being used at a rate that is sometimes double, triple, quadruple, in one case I know of, six times what the normal expectation of usage would be during peacetime. And what we have been doing is recognizing that, and we've told the services when they come back and they're resetting their force and reconstituting and recapitalizing their force, don't reset it the way it was. Reset it the way you need it to be for the future, for the 21st century. So on the one hand, there's heavy usage. On the other hand, it is providing an opportunity to adjust the capabilities of the force earlier than otherwise might have been the case. We have a substantial amount of money in the 2005 supplemental, about $12 billion, for the services to repair and rebuild and replace worn-out equipment. We're still working with OMB and the Congress to figure out exactly how we should fund it. In the one sense, it's a cost of the war. But in another sense, if you think about it, let's say a Bradley fighting vehicle is going to be used at four times or five times the rate normal, and it's used up half of its life in a much shorter period of time. What do you then do? How do you fund that now when it was used now, but it still exists as a vehicle for another half of its life? When do you come to the Congress and ask for the funds to fund that? So we're working on that, but we recognize the problem, we agree with you, and it's terribly important that we see that not just the active force, but the Guard and Reserve has the equipment repaired and fixed and in some cases replaced with even better equipment.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Let me just add, Congressman Schwartz, that on the in the supplemental, there is roughly $16 billion that goes to procurement and refurbishment of this type of equipment, which is in addition to, of course, our normal budget. So that helps particularly with the systems the Secretary was talking about that are being used up at a more rapid rate in both Afghanistan and Iraq.
Thank you, sir.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary and General, for completing the hearing. I appreciate that. I think we agree that we have the best military in history, thank goodness. We want victory in Iraq. I think it offers new hope for the world. But I've got several pretty specific worries right now. Number one, our troops face the highest stress, the highest op tempo that we've had since World War II. And that seems to be hurting recruiting and retention. Number two, we're headed towards spending $500 billion on this war, maybe even a trillion. We're borrowing most of that today from the Chinese, and the people who will be paying interest on that debt to the Chinese are going to be the generation that our young soldiers is in. I'm worried that even though we have by far the biggest defense budgets in American history, we're still having to make tough choices that will destroy some weapons platforms that perhaps are needed to transform our force, because I very much share your vision of transforming the military. Mm-hmm. I'm worried that our troops, for all that we're spending, because we're using supplemental spending devices, our troops are not really funded beyond September 30th of this year. And that's a mistake that I think the administration has repeated from last year, because you insist on supplemental spending devices, which means basically, technically, September 30th of this year, we're leaving our guys hanging. Another concern is, in your regular budget, this does not count the supplemental, the budget for the Army is actually reduced. at a time of war. How can that be? Because they're carrying the lion's share of the load. I'm worried, too, that we can't really trust the Iraqi forces, and I don't want to poor mouth them because I hope they'll perform well. But with the proliferation of militias, with the strength of the Peshmerga, worst case, we could be just equipping our own future enemies. But I hope and pray that General Petraeus, if any general can do it, I'm sure he can do it. But finally, sir, you've been Secretary of Defense twice. DOD still has the worst internal controls of any agency of federal government. And don't take my word for it. Take the General Accountability Office word for it. I think only 6 of 63 departments in your Pentagon are really able to give an audit, and perhaps Ms. Jones will be able to help with that, welcome you on board. But that's a pretty poor record of financial performance. So we're all for you. We want you to succeed, but these are serious and legitimate concerns.
Congressman Cooper, thank you. I appreciate the questions and the spirit in which they were asked. Needless to say, stress on the force is something that we've talked about here at great length. We're concerned about it. We're doing 20, 25, 30 things to reduce the stress on the force. We're increasing the size of the Army, the size of the Marines, rebalancing the active and reserve components, moving a number of military people out of civilian jobs into military jobs and replacing them with civilians and contractors, and we're making good progress. Second, you said we're spending more than ever in history. Well, that's true of every department of government generally. The fact is, when I was a congressman here in the 1960s, we were spending 10% of the gross domestic product of the United States on defense. Today, we're down to 3.3%.
But we didn't borrow it from the Chinese back then, sir.
Well, money's fungible, and we're borrowing wherever the markets are, and that's not the Department of Defense. The fact is, we are spending a relatively modest, historically, relatively since World War II, relatively modest percentage of gross domestic product on defense. It's a lot of money, don't get me wrong. But as a percentage, it is a relatively modest percentage. And I would add, this country can afford to spend that which we need to contribute to peace and stability in the world, because without it, nothing else is possible. The issue of where you put money in a supplemental or in the budget is an issue that is dealt with by the Office of Management and Budget and the Congress, and they discuss that and work that out. It's not something we decide. The Army budget, as you know, has to be looked at by the budget and the supplemental together. The Army budget is up substantially, and there are fair questions about whether or not money should be in a supplemental or in the regular budget. But if you take them together, The wartime, you say, how can you spend it during wartime? The wartime portion of the Army budget is being funded in the supplemental, as you know, which is the way wars tend to be funded. We insist on doing this way. We don't insist on doing this way. 2 years ago, I tried to do it the opposite way. I came before the Congress, and the Congress said, no, don't do it that way. Do it the other way. Fund the war in supplementals. And that's where we are today. So it's exactly backwards from the way you characterized it in terms of who's insisting on where the war funding should be. There's a good reason for putting it in the supplemental. We tried not to, and the argument was, well, you can't look into the future and tell us how that money's going to be spent, and that's true. If you put it in a supplemental, you have 6-8 more months of knowledge as to what's been spent, and therefore you can do a better job. Now, you say that leaves our troops hanging out. It doesn't at all. Our troops are going to get funded. And the executive branch will see that the supplementals are here, and it's all known, and everyone looks at the budget, they look at the supplemental, and there isn't any mystery about it, and I'm not worried about the troops getting left hanging, as you suggested. I'll let Tina respond to the other question.
Thank you. With respect to the internal controls question, we are making some progress. We now have 6 unqualified audits, and we're on our way to some others. We're working with the Marine Corps and working on our information systems to get to that. So I appreciate your question. I can assure you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Cooper, we will be working very hard on that problem.
I hope there'll be time for a second round of questions, Mr. Chairman. I see that my time has expired.
Mr. Chairman, let me go into the militia part and the Iraqi, if I may, the Iraqi security forces.
I forgot that.
A couple of data points that I think help here. As we recall, and I think we might have talked about this in our last hearing, I can't remember, Mr. Cooper, if we did or not, but security for Iraqi elections was done primarily by Iraqi security forces, both inner and outer cordons. There were, I think, 11 suicide bombers that attempted to penetrate. None of them did. So out of that, a couple of things happened. One is the Iraqi security forces had a lot of confidence in their ability, and the Iraqi people have a lot of confidence in their security forces. Confidence is important. They built their confidence over that election period. Since sovereignty, since, let's say, 1 July of last year, of 04, till now, Iraqi security forces have been killed and wounded at twice the rate of coalition forces. So they're out there doing their job, and so they've shown courage in what they do. You're right. General Petraeus is exactly the right person, and General Casey, to husband this along, and it's not just them. NATO's now starting to play a role in others to get them to the point where they have increased capabilities, and that's what we're working on. I have personally have faith in the Iraqi officers that I've met, and I'm going to go over next week, and I'll meet some more officers and other troops in the Iraqi Armed Forces. Confidence that with our support, our training, our equipping, and our mentoring, that they will be a force for good in that country.
Thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Franks.
Gentlemen, I would just reflect again the ongoing feelings of this committee. The members here appreciate all the things that you do for this country. It is not lost on us that just recently that a country who was oppressed and battered and beat down and whose people were in bondage since they call their country Babylon took free elections. And I think that's a significant day in the March of Freedom, and we owe so much of that to your valiant efforts. And having said that, I would like to try to take the conversation a little different direction here. I'm just, if it's all right, Mr. Secretary, going to address my questions to General Myers. General Myers, I'm just wondering if you believe that the dependence of our nation on its space assets is being underestimated or underappreciated in any way. Understanding that the Kinetic Energy Interceptor program has been moved back 1 year, and it occurs to me that if such a program would ever be needed, that it would be so critical to the nation. If one missile, especially in this time of terrorists trying to converge with the nuclear age, should land in American territory, that it would change our concept of freedom so profoundly as to be a completely different branch in our history here. And I'm just wondering what your own perspective is as far as are we emphasizing protecting those assets enough and developing them enough. Maybe just some general thoughts in that regard.
Well, Congressman, I think everybody that I know in the United States military and the Department of Defense understands the important role that our space assets play in our national security. And there's a limit to how much we can go on into in this open session, but let me just say that, you know, as time goes on, we understand that there are vulnerabilities associated with these systems, that we have to address those in designs of new systems, and that we're doing that. When I was commander of Space Command, one of the biggest issues that we had to deal with was trying to figure out what was happening to a particular capability if the function was interrupted. And the first thing you have to do is determine what it is that's causing the interruption, and whether it's on the orbit side of it or the ground side or the uplink or downlink. And I think we've come, and that wasn't all that long ago, but I think we've come a fairly long ways in trying to fix those problems. In other words, to warn when we're under attack, to understand better our vulnerabilities, and then to design in fixes as we bring new systems on board. One of the things that's interesting in space systems that they tend to last a long time. I can't remember now, but our GPS satellites have a very long lifespan. So if you want to change the character of the GPS constellation figure on it being a 15-year project, because you can get a new satellite up right away, but if you're going to replace them after those wear out, or when you think the upgrade's needed, it's going to take you some time to get it done. So that's just a characteristic of the systems that we have on orbit. I think our budget that's before you does a very good job of balancing our needs in space and what this country needs.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, very much.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman, the gentlelady from Georgia, Ms. McKinney.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I watched President Bush deliver a moving speech at the United Nations in September 2003, in which he mentioned the crisis of the sex trade. The president called for the punishment of those involved in this horrible business. But at the very moment of that speech, DynCorp was exposed for having been involved in the buying and selling of young women and children. While all of this was going on, DynCorp kept the Pentagon contract to administer the smallpox and anthrax vaccines and is now working on a plague vaccine through the Joint Vaccine Acquisition Program. Mr. Secretary, is it policy of the U.S. government to reward companies that traffic in women and little girls? That's my first question. My second question, Mr. Secretary, according to the Comptroller General of the United States, there are serious financial management problems at the Pentagon, to which Mr. Cooper alluded. Fiscal year 1999, $2.3 trillion missing. Fiscal year 2000, $1.1 trillion missing. And DOD is the number one reason why the government can't balance its checkbook. The Pentagon has claimed year after year that the reason it can't account for the money is because its computers don't communicate with each other. My second question, Mr. Secretary, is who has the contracts today to make those systems communicate with each other? How long have they had those contracts? And how much have the taxpayers paid for them? Finally, Mr. Secretary, after the last hearing, I thought that my office was promised a written response to my question regarding the four war games on September 11th. I have not yet received that response, but would like for you to respond to the questions that I've put to you today, and then I do expect the written response to my previous question, hopefully by the end of the week.
Thank you, Representative. First, the answer to your first question is no, absolutely not. The policy of the United States government is clear, unambiguous, and opposed to the activities that you described. The second question.
Well, how do you explain the fact that DynCorp and its successor companies have received and continue to receive government contracts?
I would have to go and find the facts, but there are laws and rules and regulations with respect to government contracts. And there are times that corporations do things they should not do, in which case they tend to be suspended for some period. There are times then that the under the laws and the rules and regulations for the that passed by the Congress and implemented by the executive branch, that corporations can get off of out of the penalty box, if you will, and be permitted to engage in contracts with the government. They're not generally not barred in perpetuity.
This company was never in the penalty box. If you could proceed to my second question, please.
The second question. I've forgotten what the second question was.
I think Ms. Jonas knows it.
Okay.
Thank you, Ms. McKinney. I appreciate the question. I appreciate your interest in our department's financial condition, and we are working very hard on that program. I've just come back recently.
I understand that you're working hard on it, but my question was, who has the contract? How long have they had that contract, and how much money have we spent on it?
In general, we spend about $20 billion in the department on information technology systems. The accounting systems are part of that. I can get you the exact number for the record of what we spend on our current, what we call legacy systems, and those that we're moving toward.
And who has the contracts?
That would be a multitude of individuals.
Could you name some, please?
Well, I think off the top of the my head, well, I would rather not. I'd rather provide that for the record.
That's not privileged information, is it?
I'm sure it's not.
Well, please. Yeah. And we still have time, so please.
I would be glad to provide for the record. I don't want to talk from the top of my head and be incorrect.
On your first question, I'm advised by Dr. Chu that it was not the corporation that was engaged in the activities you characterized, but I'm told it was an employee of the corporation, and it was some years ago in the Balkans that that took place.
It's my understanding that it continues to take place, and
is that right?
Yes.
Well, if you can give me information to that effect,
I'm sure you are interested in all of the information that I have, and I'll be more than happy to provide it to
you. Good, thank you.
But I would also like to get information from you.
Okay.
For example, the information that I just requested about who has those contracts.
Certainly.
Let me assure the gentlelady that we'll make sure that this exchange of information takes place, and. Mr. Secretary, if you can get back with us on the DynCorp story, we'll get that to the gentlelady.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
We'll get back on both of the first two questions, but the Congresswoman has raised the other question twice now, and I'd like to have General Myers respond because you mentioned it in the last hearing, and I think it would be helpful to get the answer, even though
okay.
we're on red, if you
okay.
don't mind, Mr. Chairman.
General Myers, go right ahead.
But I would like to have the answer in writing as well, as I thought my office was promised.
Okay, I don't know about the promise, Congresswoman, but could you repeat the question to make sure I'm answering the right question? This is a 9/11 question.
The question was, we had four war games going on September 11th, and the question that I tried to pose before the Secretary had to go to lunch was whether or not the activities of the four war games going on September 11th actually impaired our ability to respond to the attacks.
The answer to the question is no, did not impair our response. In fact, General Eberhardt, who was in the commander of North American Aerospace Defense Command, as he testified in front of the 9/11 Commission, I believe he told them that it enhanced our ability to respond, given that NORAD didn't have the overall responsibility for responding to the attacks today. That was an FAA responsibility. But they were two CPXs. There was one Department of Justice exercise that didn't have anything to do with the other three. And there was an actual operation ongoing because there was some Russian bomber activity up near Alaska. So
let me ask you this, then. Who was in charge of managing those war games?
And General, why don't you give the best answer you can here in a short period of time, and the gentlelady wants to get a written answer anyway, and then we can move on to other folks.
The important thing to realize is North American Aerospace Defense Command was responsible. These are command post exercises. What that means is all the battle positions that are normally not filled are indeed filled. So it was an easy transition from an exercise into a real-world situation. It actually enhanced the response. Otherwise, it would take somewhere between 30 minutes and a couple of hours to fill those positions, those battle spaces, with the right staff officers.
Mr. Chairman, begging your indulgence, was September 11th declared a national security special event day?
I have to look back. I do not know. You mean after the fact or before?
No. Because of the activities going on that had been scheduled at the United Nations that day?
I'd have to go back and check. Don't know.
Thank you.
Okay. I thank the gentlelady. The chair would ask the gentleman from South Carolina to indulge us in that I should have called on Mr. Marshall here in the regular order and missed him, and the gentleman was here. So okay. is that okay, Mr. Wilson? We'll recognize the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Marshall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate Mr. Wilson's indulgence.
Well, you're going to owe him.
Probably not very much. Earlier in this hearing, if this is a continuation of the last, Mr. Sexton asked about C-17s, and General Myers, I'm In response, you said, well, we've got this mobility capability study coming out, and you made reference also to the quadrennial review. And so it's really premature to be making judgments concerning the C-17 and what do we need, et cetera, where that platform is concerned, if I'm not mistaken, in light of the fact that these studies are in the pipeline. And at the time, I found myself thinking about the C-130J and apparently decisions having been made with regard to that platform, which is also an air mobility platform. Ms. Secretary, in your posture statement, page 4, first thing you list, if I'm not mistaken, is the reference to being able to move military forces throughout the world rapidly. There's also a reference, another page or two, to the Global Peace Operation Initiative. Again, it's moving forces around. Where the C-130J is concerned, apparently we're going to suffer some significant penalties if we do terminate what's currently in the pipeline. Just going ahead with what was on the books previously would be a good bit less expensive, it seems to me. More money, but on average, a good bit less. We've just grounded a whole bunch of C-130Es. We've got these capability studies coming out. I don't quite understand why we have made this decision with regard to the C-130Js, and I hope that we'd revisit it. We saw one of the C-130Js while we were over in the Far East. The crew of that particular plane raved about its capabilities. John Klein was with us. He's a former pilot. He was up in the cockpit. He came down raving about the capabilities of the C-130J. And I just don't think that our current budget woes should jeopardize at all our future national security and the platform needs that we have with regard to the future. And if we haven't even finished our studies, it's hard for me to see why we've planned some cuts. So,
Congressman Marshall, you may very well be right. Shortly after the budget was prepared in November and sent over to the White House for the Office of Management and Budget, some additional information came to our attention, and it was too late to get the facts sorted through. And as a result, what we did was the budget came up, and we have indicated that even before the budget was set up, we have been exploring the implications of that preliminary decision. And we think that we've got to balance the contract options with the Marine Corps requirements and with the recommendations of the mobility study. And it may very well be that we'll have to come back with a budget amendment given the information that has been brought to our attention subsequent to putting the budget to bed.
Tell my colleague, too, that when the Secretary rolled the budget out and Mr. Skelton and myself were over at the rollout, that was the Secretary put that asterisk on the C-130 program at that time, that there was an ongoing look at it. And
Ms. Secretary, very briefly, in the hopes of getting maybe another amendment in the budget.
Not likely.
Well, this is a very, very small one. We've got 5 two-year colleges that train officers. They get their commission at the end of their two-year hitch. Many of them want to go on and complete their degree. They're permitted to do so. In last year's authorization bill, language was inserted that permits the Department of Defense to fund scholarships for these students. I don't think that anything is in the budget currently to fund those scholarships that are now authorized. To me, at least, it seems like an ideal tool to assist in recruiting students for the two-year colleges. We've got a shortage of officers. I think the quality would go up, and I know that the recruiters for those colleges would be out there touting the fact that, DOD, under conditions obviously that DOD would set, would, if a student did well, et cetera, would be providing scholarship assistance to complete a 4-year degree. Time and grade, et cetera. There are a lot of advantages, and I also think that the total budget associated with this is very, very small.
These are not ROTC, it's something else?
Well, it's the 2-year military college students. They, I don't know whether they're called ROTC, frankly, but we've got 5 of these 2-year colleges, and they graduate officers that then receive their commission after their 2 years.
Is it by service, or is it all Army?
I think they're all Army.
They're all Army? I'll ask Dr. Chu and his team to take a look at it. I'm just not knowledgeable about it.
I've been given the figure $2.4 million to fully fund scholarships for all the graduates to complete their 4-year degree. What a great 2.4 for these. Now I may have the wrong figure.
Is that just for these five colleges?
For those five colleges.
Yeah, but how many are there in the U.S.?
Well, there are five of these particular colleges in the entire country.
Ah.
2.4, and then you'd multiply by four once the program is ramped up altogether, and that would be for scholarships for all of them. I don't think you'd give scholarships to all of them. So DoD would set the rules, but it just seems to be a small amount of money to increase the quantity and quality of our officer corps.
Thank you. We'll look into it and get back to you.
The ranking member had a brief comment on that.
Mr. Secretary, to add to this discussion, there are five dedicated military junior colleges in the nation. Georgia, Missouri, Alabama, New Mexico, and Pennsylvania. Authorization last year authorized a brand new second lieutenant graduating from one of these military junior colleges the opportunity to go to a four-year university or college that has a senior ROTC unit and there assist with the faculty and receive a certain stipend until that person graduated. And then they, of course, could go active duty from that point on. They cannot go active duty after a two-year commission, but they can go active duty after a four-year commission. And this keeps them green and also helps in the ROTC senior unit that's at University of Missouri, wherever the case may be. It was my understanding that there was an appropriation for this last year, and there seemed to have been a question about that, and we're trying to check that out. And if you would check it from the other end, I think it would be very, very helpful, because we think we did some good work on this, and Mr. Marshall was very, very active in helping do this, and I hope that clarifies a little bit.
Thank you. We'll certainly look into it.
I thank the gentleman and the very patient gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I was happy to defer to Congressman Marshall. I had the opportunity to visit Iraq with Congressman Marshall, and he served with distinction in Vietnam. And so the troops related to him, and it was just a really inspiring experience to me to learn of his service and his dedication to our troops. And Mr. Secretary in General, I want to thank you for what you're doing to promote our troops. And I've never been prouder of our military. My experience of 31 years service in the Army National Guard, I've got three sons in your command. I'm very grateful. My oldest son has just returned from a year in Iraq, where he felt like they were making a difference, promoting a civil society. And then I've got two sons in the Army Guard, one son in the Navy. Additionally, I'm very grateful that I've had the opportunity to visit three times in Iraq with the troops in Afghanistan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan. It's amazing the new greatest generation, how capable they are. I am happy to see you have Dr. Chu with you. I will be meeting with him soon in regard to the Guard and Reserve Readiness and Retention Act. I'm working with Congressman Tom Lathan in regard to providing of TRICARE. Improving, hopefully, the retirement benefits for recruiting and retention. Additionally, we'll be discussing moving to six-month rotations for Guard members. But what I've been most impressed about, as we were touring with Congressman Marshall and Congressman Skelton, were the Iraqi recruits serving in the police and in the Army. And earlier in the hearing, you indicated the prior hearing, of the level of progress, and can you restate again where we are? I've just been so impressed by the commitment of the people of Iraq.
Thank you very much, Congressman. You want to put?
I think put the one chart up.
We, as of 7 March this year, the numbers of Iraqis serving in the Iraqi security forces has gone up to 142,000 individuals who are on duty, out of training, and with the appropriate equipment. There are another number of people who are currently in training, and that number fluctuates from month to month. What those numbers do not tell you, however, is all of the other things that are critically important, which you know from your experience in the military, such as the chain of command and the non-commissioned officers and the availability of intelligence and the availability of lift and mobility. So we're in the process of refining our ability to calibrate and report on the quality of those as well as the quantity. But as General Myers said, they did a wonderful job on the election. They provided security for 5,000 locations, internal perimeter and the external perimeter. The volunteers continue to be up every month. They've lost a lot of lives, something in excess of the coalition forces' loss of lives by a fairly sizable margin, which suggests that they're actually out there doing their job. And that's important, and we're going to work our heads off to see that it gets done right.
And they're being properly equipped to compete with the terrorist?
It varies. If you have a policeman, which is part of that number, they're obviously equipped to be a policeman. If you have a special police commando unit that has the kind of assignment you're talking about, a counterinsurgency role, they are equipped to do that type of thing. And then there's the regular army that's equipped to do what they do. The Border Patrol is equipped to do what a Border Patrol person does. And it's the training and the equipping is notably different depending on what the function of these various elements of the security forces may be.
And you've referenced it. It's somewhat of a backhanded compliment. A level of their effectiveness is that they have come under attack. And if they were compliant, if they were incompetent, the terrorists would not have targeted these very brave people, and that's what Congressman Marshall and I saw, and we were able at the Police Training Academy to meet impromptu with the persons in training, and they were so enthusiastic, so patriotic about their country.
They are. They're very proud.
Let me just give you a couple of anecdotes, because I asked a question a day ago or 2 days ago. Provide me some anecdotes on how the Iraqi forces are doing. Then this is what we got back. This is in the last 72 hours. One Iraqi unit conducted a brigade combined offensive operation to capture and detain members of the insurgency, a cell that was suspected of trafficking in weapons. This was a near simultaneous operation assault on four separate objectives, incorporating ground and air infiltration. The results were they detained 22 personnel and a modest cache of arms and documents which will support future operations. But that's for those who serve, that's a pretty complex operation they conducted. Another one, an Iraqi unit, this case a battalion, did a combined operation that targeted a suspected vehicle-borne improvised explosive bomb maker's residence and garage. They did that. They detained two people and over 10,000 pounds of ammonium nitrate explosive. So they're out there and they're working, and they're not all perfect, but their level of enthusiasm, I said, after elections and their degree of confidence is really high, and we're capitalizing on that. They're developing very good leadership. The people that work with them day in and day out, for the most part, have confidence that they're gonna do just fine.
Thank you again so much for your service.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. And Mr. Secretary, General Myers, you know that, like the gentleman who just spoke, almost everybody on this committee has been to Iraq and Afghanistan multiple times. Had a real chance to see the troops, to take a look at the operation, and our members are very dedicated and try to translate that focus and that observation in theater into meaningful legislation here in the House. And the gentleman from Rhode Island, Mr. Langevin, is next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Secretary Rumsfeld, General Myers, Secretary Jonas, thank you for being here today. General Myers and Secretary Rumsfeld, the ongoing operations in Iraq and Afghanistan clearly illustrated the importance of a military that can respond to asymmetric threats, insurgencies, and non-state actors. And I know that the Department of Defense is focused on these and other emerging threats as you begin the quadrennial defense review. And Secretary Rumsfeld, I understand that There's been discussion of broadening the scope of the upcoming QDR to ascertain how we could use non-military assets and interagency cooperation to address the threats of terrorism and proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. And I do believe strongly that the U.S. really has to use all of its strengths, including soft power assets like foreign aid, diplomacy, and education to prevent terrorism from taking root. And I really do hope that you'll continue to pursue this comprehensive and interagency approach to the next QDR. At the same time, though, I'm concerned that our uncertain future in Iraq could incorrectly influence our understanding and expectation of future security threats. You know, we need to make sure that we're still capable of responding to more conventional threats and that we don't overemphasize one combat scenario at the expense of others. So on that point, for example, the FY 2006 budget's low shipbuilding numbers, including delayed procurement rates for Virginia-class submarines and DDX, are particularly worrisome, especially in light of other nations' efforts to increase their naval capabilities. So on that point, what are you doing to ensure that the QDR will prepare us to fight the next war instead of simply reacting to the current one?
Congressman, that's an issue that we think through, think about, discuss, and worry about, and on a continuing basis. The old saying is that the military tends to be prepared to fight the last war, not the next war. And on the other hand, it would be a mistake if all we did was think about the next war and not recognize that you can't look out 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years, and these weapon systems last that long, with perfect certainty and clarity. So what we have to do is to hedge the bets. We have to make choices, and that's what we do. We are making a big effort in the Quadrennial Defense Review to do exactly what you've said, to make sure we're looking at the present, to be sure, the asymmetrical threats we're dealing with, the nonlinear battlefield, but also to recognize the changes that are taking place in Asia and the kinds of capabilities that the United States could be facing in 10, 15, 20 years from countries that today are not in a position to present those capabilities. I think you mentioned the shipbuilding budget.
Matter of fact, I did.
You did. Let me just comment on it, because it's such an important part of our military capability. We're a maritime nation. We're a Pacific nation. We're an Atlantic nation. We're a nation that has interests around the world. And the American people and those of our trading partners benefit greatly from a peaceful world, from a world where freedom of the seas exists and we have access to the seas. The numbers of ships we have in the inventory of the United States have been going down somewhat. Fortunately, what's been happening simultaneously is the deployability of our ships has been going up. Take a Navy where you're capable of deploying one-fifth of our ships, which has been the pattern in the past. Take a Navy, for example, of 400. I think if you take one-fifth of that, it's about 80 ships deployed at any given time. And what's important is not the number of ships you have, because the ones in the dry docks aren't doing you much good. It's the ones you're capable of deploying, of course. If you have fewer ships, not 400, but 350, but you can deploy a third of them, which is where we are today, instead of a fifth, as it's been, we're at the point where we can begin deploying a third. That's 116 ships you'd be deploying instead of 80, even though you've got a smaller Navy. Now, that's only part of the answer. The other part of the answer on the Navy is that how do you do that? And the way you do it is they've been using sea swaps with crews. They have been investing a lot more money in the ability to turn a ship around when it's in repair and overhaul. And And that's the kind of thing, getting much more out of the Navy we have, the capabilities of the Navy we have, and being able to do things, rapidly deploy them, and instead of bringing the ship back and forth every time you change the crew, leave the ship there and change the crew out there, in which case the transit time both ways is saved, for example. And I think that Secretary England and Vern Clark have both done a very good job in increasing the both the capability and the lethality of our Navy.
If I can go back and talk about the Quadrennial Defense Review for just a minute, to add on to what the Secretary said, what was it? It was about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, month and a half ago, we had all the combatant commanders in, all the Joint Chiefs, all the senior leadership in the department that spent, I think it was a half a day, on the terms of reference for the Quadrennial Defense Review. Just on the terms of reference, just how we're going to do it and what we're going to look at. So you had the most senior military minds and I think some of the best military minds in this country and the senior civilian leadership of the department working on exactly what you just brought up. So as we go forward in this 21st century, that we're as prepared as we can be to understand what capabilities we need to secure this country. So I'm very comfortable in the process as it's been set up, that we will not wander down a trail, if you will, that might be ill-advised or might be based on what we did a month ago or 2 months ago. It's going to be a much broader, I think a much deeper look than that.
There was a strange article in the paper recently that suggested that I had some sort of a black box and I was imposing a top-down quadrennial defense review. It's nonsense. As Dick Myers said, we've spent just dozens and dozens and dozens of hours with the senior military, the combatant commanders, the services, the service chiefs, the service secretaries, the undersecretary, the vice chiefs. They have worked their heads off on this thing, and there isn't a way in the world that I'm smart enough or wise enough or knowledgeable enough or experienced enough to do that thing myself. That's just not how it's done in there. I can't imagine. It was a world-class thumbsucker by whoever wrote it.
The half a day I referred to was the end of the process, not the beginning. The secretary is exactly right. I mean, we've spent several months trying to get up to that half a day where we had all the senior leadership in to make the final tweaks, which resulted, by the way, in some fairly significant changes, which had to come back and be looked at again. But it's a very robust process. I didn't read the article, but I'd like to see your black box.
Gentlemen, I appreciate your answers today. I see my time's expired, but thank you for being here and your testimony.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Minnesota, Mr. Klein.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen and lady, for coming back. We front row folks really do appreciate that an awful lot. I have been in discussions since I got here with you, Mr. Secretary, and you, General, and with David Chu sitting back there about utilization of the Guard and Reserve, and clearly we're using that reserve component at a level that hasn't been seen since the first part of the Korean War. And it seems to me, and I think it seems to you, that as we've increased the use of the reserve component, we need to start to rethink and have started to rethink all the other issues surrounding that. How do we provide for their health care? What are we going to do about their retirement? What are we doing about their pay and bonuses and reenlistment and all those things? And I know that we're going to continue that discussion and dialogue as we go forward. We've also, of course, been talking a lot about transformation, with a lot of emphasis appropriately on what the Army's doing. But I've just recently been hearing about some transformation ideas for the Air Force that I haven't had a chance to explore and I haven't heard from the department yet. And I wonder if we could hear a little bit about it today. The term, as I understand it, is the Air Force's future total force, which would fundamentally change how the Air National Guard and Reserve units work. And the understanding that I have, and I'm looking at my notes here and may be wrong, the reason for the question is that we'd shift from standalone community-based Air National Guard and Reserve units to an associate unit concept in which Air National Guard and Reserve personnel would drill at active duty installations and fly active component aircraft, and so we'd really reconfigure what that Air Guard and Reserve looks like. Is that something you can talk about today, or are we not quite there yet?
We're not there yet, and the Air Force has been thinking about it. It also, I'm afraid, may very well, because it isn't far enough along for me to have been even briefed on it yet.
We have spies everywhere, so it's... You
know. Yeah, well, I'm not surprised. That's good. We like that. But it is not something that that I could comment on. Or
then could I ask you or the general or anyone to comment on what you're thinking, what we're looking at in this utilization of the reserve component? The National Guard and the reserves are no longer, as they have been for literally decades, the weekend warriors that we used to talk about, where they would go and drill on a weekend and maybe a couple of weeks in the summer, but now we're calling them up. They're doing a great job. We're sending them to the Balkans and to Iraq and to Afghanistan, and they are serving an awful lot of active duty time, and you know there have been calls for better health care for them, TRICARE, some steps have been made there. But it seems to me we really need to be in the process of completely relooking at how we take care of and employ the Guard and Reserve, just based on the extensive use that we now have. I still think we're over 40% in theater right now is from the reserve component.
I'll make a quick comment and then Dick Myers can respond. But if you look at the chart over there, what you'll see is that the Guard and Reserve, as I recall, is somewhere in the neighborhood of in the high 800,000s on the selected reserve, not counting the individual ready reserve. So you've got 880,000 or something like that. Of those, about 60% have not been mobilized yet. So the problem we've had is we've got stress on the force because we've put more stress on some rather than even stress on all. And that's where we're going through this process of rebalancing the active and the reserve components one against the other, but we're also rebalancing within the active force and within the reserve and reserve component. Dick, you want to comment?
You bet. Congressman Klein, a couple of comments. I think we're using the reserve component as we had designed to use them, and that is, if you're a nation at war, you're going to need the reserves to go to war. We have invested or had made a decision over a decade ago to put a lot of our combat support, combat service support into the reserve component. Now we're a nation at war. We need that combat support, combat service support. So, I mean, it's not unusual if you're a nation at war that you call in your reserves. That's what we're asking them to do. The Secretary is right. Are our reserves set for the 21st century, or are they set for the 20th century and the Cold War and the Industrial Age? The answer is the latter. That's how they've been set up. That's how they've been resourced. So a lot really needs to change. It is inside, I think, every service changing dramatically in terms of the balance between the active and the reserve component. They've all looked at that. The Army's perhaps making the biggest change, which is going to affect about 100,000 people in terms of the balance between active and reserves and the mix. The forces you can get to quickly. The services all treat the reserves and utilize the reserves in slightly different manners. You mentioned the Air Force plan. I have not been fully briefed on it, but I do know what it probably works at. It's issues they've had, they've been working for a long time, and that is units that are, I think the example would be Warner Robins Air Force Base, where there's a Joint Stars unit, the E-8 aircraft, where they alternate between a reserve commander and an active duty commander, and the unit is similarly constructed. And the ease with which the Air Force reaches down and utilizes the reserve component is much different, say, than the United States Army. All those issues have to be worked. They'll be looked at in the QDR. There's resource implications. How ready do you want your reserves to be? Do we have the right mix? We know that's not right. We know we need a lot more military intelligence, transporters, military police than we do artillery battalion. So all of that is going to change over time. But you're also right in that the reserves are doing a great work. But we are a nation at war. We need them. They're doing what they swore to do. I don't think there's any reservist with a straight face that can say I just signed up for weekends. That's not what they signed up. They signed up to support and defend the Constitution of their country, and that's what they're doing in a marvelous way. So,
yes, sir, and I thank you for the answer, and I agree with you that we should be using the reserve component of time of war. It's not been our recent history, as you know, and in this way, it's not really the expectation of a lot of those men and women. I know they're serving willingly and in many cases eagerly, but I'm just suggesting that I hope that we are proactively looking at all of those personnel policies, because we are using the reserve component now, in many cases, very much like the active component. I'm just suggesting we need to address those. You've heard some suggestions here today of legislation and so forth. I'm not suggesting the answer,
right,
but
that.
We really do need to look at it. And I thank
right.
you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're absolutely
thank
you. Right.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Oklahoma, one of our newest members, Mr. Bourne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I echo Mr. Klein's comments about our appreciation for you all being here, and for us on the front row who rarely get to ask a question. This is actually one of my first. So,
if this committee gets any bigger, Mr. Bourne, you're going to be sitting at the witness table with them.
That's correct.
It'll be very cozy.
I want to make a comment and then also want to end with a question. There were a group of us, actually we returned from Iraq on Tuesday, a group of freshman members, two Democrats, two Republicans, and we were actually led by Congressman Cole from my home state of Oklahoma. I want to let you all know that we're really proud of what's going on over there. We're really proud of the work. We met with General Petraeus. He is doing an excellent job at training those Iraqis. We were able to go to Jordan and visit some of the facilities and meet with the people who were training the Iraqis to be able to be involved in self-governance, frankly. We were also able to meet with some of the Iraqi leadership from the Shia coalition, from the Kurdish, and from the Sunnis, and each one of them was very optimistic. I think we're making significant progress, and I want to say that they were quoting the Constitution to us. They were quoting Madison. And it's a great example to the rest of our country. A lot of those leaders know more about our Constitution than some of us do. And it was quite a sight. The morale was high. I was able to meet with many Oklahomans one-on-one. They're in great spirits. And, you know, the national media doesn't talk about that, unfortunately. They don't talk about some of the good things that we're doing, and we are doing some great things in Iraq. It made me even more proud to be an American, and I really appreciate their service. I think it's so vitally important that we stay the course, that we support these young men and women, something that I plan to do when I vote for the supplemental, because we've got to let democracy flourish, not only in Iraq, but in the region. But along those lines, you know, there is a high cost when we go into any place and we're involved in combat. After I was elected, I had three young men that were killed from my district. Actually, Lyle Reimer from Roland, Robbie Hendrickson from Broken Bow, and Jason Hendricks from Claremore. And their families are very proud of the service that they've given to our country. But the question I have for you, Mr. Secretary, is in the why did the FY 2005 supplemental request only provide funds for increasing the death gratuity and the SGLI benefits through January 31st of this year, and why was the balance of the FY 2005 and thereafter left unfunded? And I think that's very important. I want to thank you all for raising that benefit, but we want to make sure that it's continually funded. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much, Congressman Bourne. The answer is that, well, it's really twofold. My understanding is that the death benefit issue is still a matter under discussion between the executive branch and between the two houses of Congress. Until a resolution is made as to what the actual numbers ought to be and what the scope of it ought to be, it would not be possible to predict precisely what the number would be. Second, there's no way, of course, to predict the number of deaths there might be. And as a result, because this is under discussion, my guess is that there is some money, I believe, that was put in, which was probably a continuum from earlier years, probably plussed up for what their best guess might be. But if and when the matter is resolved, as I certainly hope it will be, in a manner that's appropriate for the service that these folks are giving our nation, I am sure that the budget will be addressed And if it requires reprogramming funds or and some transfer authority, obviously that would be used because the law would exist and we would comply with the law.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you.
Okay. I thank the gentleman and the gentlelady from Washington, Ms. McMorris.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I actually don't have a question today.
I thank the gentlelady, Mr. Ryan from Ohio, and it looks like Mr. Ryan is, you know, we may wrap this thing up pretty quick here, Mr. Secretary. And the gentleman, another gentleman in the front row, Mr. Davis from Kentucky.
Reporting from OP freshman, Mr. Chairman. My former comrades appreciate that. I continue to be amazed at the progress in the combat power and the ability to project that power in the 15 years or so since I left active duty. And I think the military is doing an outstanding job. Morale in our Guard, Reserve troops in our district coming home remains extremely high. Having grown up in the Vietnam era, it's a telling difference in the spirit of the soldiers. I was visiting with one Marine friend of mine in Bethesda who was wounded last week on a second tour in an IED incident, and made a telling comment to me. And he said that they're not shooting at us anymore. In the area in Fallujah where they were, that the insurgents are now reduced in the sector that he was operating into IEDs, which are pernicious and deadly and very dangerous. But I think it's a great encouragement to the doctrine that's being applied tactically, the adaptation of our forces to their changes in the situation. One thing that has come up as a concern to me, looking at mobilization and Guard and Reserve units, the pace of the operations tempo, especially for the Army and the Marine Corps right now, looking at the Marine Float Plan, for example, I know dwell time is the smallest of all the services. In-country time is beginning to expand. And simply looking at it as a barometer, I'm somewhat concerned about surge capability. Should another threat emerge in some other theater, possibly in the Central Command area of responsibility, but for example, if something in Asia, Latin America develop, from an operational concept, I'd appreciate your comments on how you propose dealing with that within the current force structure.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Congressman Davis. This is something that General Myers and the chiefs and I spend a good deal of time on. One of the jobs of the Pentagon, of course, is, as you know, to look at what kinds of contingencies conceivably could arise, what might we do about them. I'd say a couple of things. First, the chiefs on a regular basis review the types of contingencies and the responsibilities of the United States and report to us what their judgment is as to our capability to deal with additional kinds of capabilities that could arise. And uniformly, they believe that our military is capable of performing. I'd say one other thing before asking General Myers to comment. I sat there with one of our four-star Army officers one day, and he was reporting to me that one of our units was what we call C3 in terms of readiness. That is to say, down and not at the C1 level, which would be where you would want everybody theoretically. And I looked him in the eye and I said, General, if you had to go to war tomorrow, would you rather go to war with the C1 division that just arrived in Iraq or the C3 division that just got home from Iraq? And is C3 because they just got home? And he said, in a minute, I'd go to war with the C3 group. Now, what does that say? It says something I think very important. It says that the United States of America doesn't want to be in a war. But when we are in a war, our warriors get very good at what they do. And we have, for the first time since the end of the last war, battle-hardened veterans who've been there, who know what they're doing, who have fought in the 21st century. Second, every system and procedure and process in the department
our deployment process, our redeployment process, our contingency planning process. Every one of those was back in the industrial age 3 years ago. Today, they're not perfect, but they are 10 times better than they were. And they are in the information age, and they're coming in. And we're revamping them and fixing them and improving them and strengthening them. So on the one hand, the personnel in the armed forces of the United States today are absolutely superb. They're well-trained, and in addition, they're experienced. And second, the ability of the institution, the processes that we have to go through to get people from one place to another, to support them, to sustain them. And we've moved millions of people and changed people out and done left seat, right seat, and brought them back home and re-equipped them and adapted to the changing battlefield as the enemy with a brain keeps adjusting what they're doing. And this United States military is so much better today than it was 3 years ago, notwithstanding the stress, notwithstanding the wear and tear in the equipment. And we are capable. Dick, do you want to comment?
There's not a lot more to say, I don't think, except that there is a series of, I'll call them war games, but they're seminar war games, where we periodically check our ability to fulfill the commitment that the Secretary has made to the President in terms of our capabilities of our Department of Defense. And we can do exactly as the Secretary said. We can meet our obligations as we have in our strategy. We always have the problems, of course, of things that are in high demand when you have a contingency, whether they're the intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance assets, or strategic airlift, those sorts of things. But we have ways to handle all that. We work this almost by unit these days because of how busy we are. But we're very confident that we can meet the security needs of this country.
You know, there's one other thing, Mr. Congressman, that I'd want to add. If you think about it, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, I would go around Europe and talk to friends from back when I was ambassador to NATO, and they were worried about us. They were worried about the United States of America and wondered about the fact, for example, that in the Balkans, when somebody strayed over a line, everyone pulled back several miles. They were worried about Somalia and the problems there, where the United States made decisions that left question marks in the minds of other countries in the world. We've seen intelligence where Saddam Hussein made comments about the United States won't do this, they can't sustain anything, they'll cut and run. And the world has seen in the last 3.5 years the capability of the United States of America to go into Afghanistan, a landlocked country, all the way across the globe, and with 20,000, 15,000 troops working with the Afghans, do what 200,000 Soviets couldn't do in a decade. They've seen the United States and the coalition forces go into Iraq, and the world has seen a vivid demonstration of the power and capability and agility of the armed forces of the United States. That has to have a deterrent effect on people. It's true, we're doing a lot in the world right now, but if you put yourself in the shoes of a country that might decide they'd like to make mischief, they have a very recent, vivid example of the fact that the United States has the ability to deal with mischief.
With the chairman's indulgence, may I respond?
Very briefly, and then we need to...
I'll yield you 1 minute. How's that?
That's good.
It's certainly good that the worries have been transferred across the ocean. I agree wholeheartedly in the latitude 1040 windows in our highest threat areas. There's no question that the Operation Iraqi Freedom, specifically with the rapid destruction of with an enemy force, sent great ripples. Tremendous benefits are being yielded all over the Islamic world right now. Don't dispute that at all. Commend the strategy. I think it's been outstanding in output. And really, my question points to is this window of vulnerability as we're transforming the military as the force is being pushed right now. Great troops doing a great job. Was just looking at that surge capability as far as force structure and staffing.
No, I understand.
So, yield back my time.
Thank you.
Okay. I thank the gentleman, and thank him for a very good set of questions. And the gentleman from Hawaii, Mr. Abercrombie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You suppose we could put that other poster up there that has the Iraqi Security Forces update that was there? Mr. Chairman, if that refers to what we had last week.
Yeah, I think that's the same set of things we had last week, I believe.
That's right. No. General Myers, this is the third year of transitioning responsibility. Although the newspapers seem to think this is something that got discovered in the last 60 days or something like that, this is the third year. Now, you've got a number there, apparently updated over the last 8 days or so, 142,472. Now, that includes, does it not, as your poster shows there, police, highway patrol, and so on. These people are not trained for counterinsurgency. I mean, this is like somebody getting out with a little stop sign at the school crossing. So that's not what we're dealing with here. We eliminate that. General Casey used several at somewhat the same numbers, 140,000 this week. And I believe there was an agreement that what we're really talking about a third of that are the kinds of people that you're talking about here capable of dealing with insurgencies that are trained and equipped and are mission-oriented in that direction. Now, my understanding is, from our briefings and all, and without going into some of the more classified details and so on, that we've got 80,000 plus Peshmerga troops still operating, generally in the north. Our information also is that they, for all intents and purposes, have not yet been integrated into this army that we're talking about. So they outnumber, if we even grant the number 60 there, they have at least a third, again, greater numbers, trained, fighting, capable of fighting, have been fighting. At the same time, General Abizade said, just prior to General Casey, that these militias of which you have mentioned today and has been mentioned by other members are to be demobilized. If I remember correctly, that demobilization agreement or the understanding that we have is that was last June, a year's time period. They're supposed to be demobilized by June, and General Abizade reiterated here this week that was indeed to be the case. So far as I can tell, not a single one of these militias has been demobilized, and I'm not even sure what that word means anymore. If they're not going to be demobilized, or if you're not going to be able to meet that deadline of June, just exactly what is it that we're talking about in terms of increased confidence that you mentioned today? I don't doubt your anecdotal a recitation here today, and I commend them for it, and I certainly understand and appreciate all the effort and hard work that's gone into it. But I don't know what increased confidence. I just picked up today's paper at random because it's a Gannett paper, so nobody can accuse it of being the notorious corporate left wing of the New York Times or the Washington Post who supported the war. Bodies of 41 execution victims discovered in Iraq, headless women and children. And then they go on inside to talk about this new army. What I'm trying to get at, and what I have not been able to get a clear answer on, is over and above what my old journalism teacher used to call glittering generalities about what this Iraqi army is supposed to do and the timetable that it has with respect to providing security. Exactly what are the capabilities in the context of this supplemental budget and the and the annual budget that we have to authorize right now, exactly what are the capabilities that you expect in relation to the expectation that you have as to how long American troops will be required to be there, either in support of them, to supplement them, or to supplant them? I think it's a fair question at this stage.
Oh, it's a very fair question. And I think we have another chart. Do we have the sawtooth chart? Because it helps remind us where we've been. And you mentioned 3 years, and I don't have 3 years, unless I've missed
that. Well, this is in the third year. Well, I'm referring back to the time when the chairman and myself and some other members went to Iraq. I believe we were the first congressional group to actually be on the ground in Baghdad. In fact, it was the day that Ambassador Bremer took control from General Garner, and we had a discussion just like this on that day about what the numbers of Iraqi troops would be and what the timetable would be, and I'm dating my time from that.
Right. That was probably June of that was May or June or July of 2003. So we're not we're not into our third year yet. We're
okay.
Coming up on the end of our second year.
Well, I'm talking about the budget that we the context I have is that the budget that we are expected to pass in the next few weeks.
But nevertheless, as we've tried to measure the capability and capacity of this armed forces, we started out in that time frame with virtually no Iraqi security forces, and we started counting what the Iraqis said they had, and you can see from that chart, and I think we handed it out last time, so you probably might not be able to see it from there.
I understand it.
So we have changed our baseline at times, and now our baseline is trained and equipped. We need to measure their capability. And now we have a sufficient force, 142,000, of which you correctly said some aren't going to be able to fight the insurgency. It does not mean they're not important. They all have roles to play. They will get to critical mass, which is your real question. They will get to critical mass when they're not only trained and equipped, but properly led, and that everything else we're trying to do in that country comes along as well. Good governance, the rule of law, economic progress, all those things.
I understand the theory.
Okay. Well, it's more than theory. It's based on years and years of history with insurgencies. So it's way beyond theory.
But that presumes, excuse me, General, that presumes an integrated force. And part of my question was, and I'm trying to understand how this is being managed within these budget constraints that we're talking about, and which the Secretary has alluded to in terms of you can't necessarily see where you're going, but what you can see is what you have. What you have is an organized force, the Peshmerga, 80,000 plus.
Well, let me reply then. And we have militias. I've never heard the June integration date, but I know the Iraqi government's intention is to get the militias to either integrate with the army or disband. It turns out it's their problem. The Peshmerga is not a problem. I don't know why anybody thinks that's a problem. It's in an area where there's not much conflict, and what happens to it will be a decision for the Iraqi government. In terms of getting these Iraqi security forces responsible for their own security, General Casey, I think, was in front of this committee not too long ago.
Yes.
And I assume that he was asked a similar question, and I know he responded to that question. Iraqi security forces, they are going to build to 10 divisions. They have specific areas in the country they're going to be responsible for. We in the coalition are going to be with them to help them do their job. And as they build their capacity, they will take over security.
Excuse me, General, because my time is short. I'm not trying to interrupt you so much as I'm trying to get a perspective here. I'm asking you, what is the relationship, particularly in terms of the expectations you have regarding our forces being there, either complementing, supplementing, or however they're going to do it what you just outlined with the Peshmerga? Are the Peshmerga going to be integrated into that army, or are they going to be something that you kind of airily referred to as, well, that's up there somewhere, and that's up to the Iraqi government to handle that?
Well, in the end, it is up to the Iraqi government.
Pardon me?
In the end, it is up to the Iraqi government. But if you're asking, when are we going to start reducing our forces, that is going to be a decision that General Abizaid and General Casey will make, and their next assessment is going to be sometime in June. They'll come back to the Secretary and myself and say, we think we see it going this way, and we'll make decisions based on that. The supplemental has the resources we need to equip and train and mentor the Iraqi forces, the Afghani forces, and we're not going to sit here and put, especially an open hearing, and put any kind of timeline on when we think we're going to draw down. That's just not. We rely on the field to tell us that. I mean, it has to be based on results, not on dates.
Well, I didn't even ask you about a drawdown. I simply tried to...
I'm trying to figure out what your question is, sir. I'm working very hard trying to figure it out, so...
Well, if you can't...
Well, I've tried every...
Are the militias going to be demobilized in this process?
The plan is that the militias will be either demobilized or integrated into the Iraqi security forces.
Who's going to do it?
That's up for the Iraqis to do. That is as much a political issue as it is a military issue. So it's up. That's a question for our State Department, certainly not the Department of Defense.
And, you can't give an idea. Is there a plan in place? Is there some kind status of forces agreement with regard to that?
I will get
with
you
this new government.
I will get you that for the record. You bet.
I can respond to that. The United States and the coalition are operating under the UN resolution. When the Iraqi government moves, took sovereignty, and now is in the process of developing its transitional government and then a constitution, a status of forces agreement would be arranged with the Iraqi government in that period as they go forward towards the end of this year, and those discussions very likely would start with the transitional government.
Secretary, is there a status of forces agreement between the Iraqi army and the Peshmerga?
Oh, no. I'll respond.
Okay.
You keep raising the Peshmerga, which I feel like General Myers...
And avoid it.
Can I respond? I'm surprised that it's raised for this reason.
And Mr. Secretary, if you can respond, but wrap it up fairly quickly, because we're going to have a few more folks.
Okay, I'll do my best.
We need to make sure we get everybody, up in the queue.
Okay, one of the issues that's currently being debated by the political people who ran for election and are going to be seated in the transitional assembly is that issue.
Yes.
And you know that,
yes.
And I know that, and how they will solve it, I do not know. But I can tell you this, there are already Peshmerga who've been demobilized and put into some of those 142,000 numbers you've seen. So there's some of that's already happened. Second, with your broader question with respect to militias generally, there is no way to answer that question about all militias because they are very different. And as you know all of this, you've been there, but some of them are issues, militias you would want to demobilize. Only the Iraqi government can do that. Second, there are some that you very likely would not want to demobilize and you'd want to integrate, and the Iraqis are going to have to do that, as Dick Myers said, on a case-by-case basis, and that's going to be part of the political discussions that are going forward. It'll be interesting to see.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Bartlett.
Thank you very much for returning. In the 40s and the early 50s, there was a geologist at Shell Oil Company by the name of M. King Hubbard, who watched the discovery and the pumping and the exhaustion of individual oil fields. They always followed a bell curve. And the peak of the bell curve was when half of the field was exhausted. With that information, he concluded that if he knew the total field, the total reserves in the United States, he could predict when the United States would reach the peak of that bell curve. In 1956, he predicted that that would happen in 1970 if there were no perturbations. It did, in fact, happen in 1970, and every year since then, we have found less oil and pumped less oil. He and then a gentleman named Colin Campbell, following him, using his approach, looked at the world, and they said, if we really could determine the total amount of reserves in the world, we'd be able to predict when the world would reach that peak. And they did that, and it was 1995, if there were no perturbations. But there were perturbations. There was 1973, there was the oil price shocks, and there was a worldwide recession, which reduced the demand for oil, and so the peak was pushed out to who knows when, but perhaps 2005. If you noticed, oil is hovering at about $54 or so dollars a barrel. There was an article in the paper today that said that there was a surge capability of 1 to 2 million barrels a day worldwide. that is nowhere near enough to meet the increased demands. China last year increased their use of oil by 30%. They, as you know, have been going around the world securing oil assets and other assets to make sure they have access to oil. They've been in our backyard. They're in Venezuela, they're in Colombia, they're in Brazil. I know that because oil is so important to our national economy and to our military, that you all are very concerned about this. And I would like to know, sir, if you could put me in touch with those in your organization who are concerned with this challenge, I'd be very appreciative of that.
We will certainly do that. I'll personally see that that gets done. And it is a fascinating subject. You obviously have invested a lot of time in the subject. It's an important one to the country. It's an important one to the department. The other perturbations that occur, of course, is the higher the price goes, the greater investment in exploration, and the greater the conservation efforts that take place. And I assume those are perturbations that somebody developed some numbers on and tried to calculate to what extent there's elasticity there. But it's sure beyond my capability to predict it.
Yeah, these are all challenges, of course, that we face when dealing with this problem. The discoveries of ordinarily oil is discovered about 40 years before you reach its peak production. And as you may have noticed, there have been no major notices of oil discoveries in the last 10 years. That's because there have been none. And if you look at the world oil discoveries, they have been going downhill now since about 40 years ago. We now have very good techniques, seismic techniques for discovering oil. It's very unlikely that there's much oil out there that we haven't found. There will be a little. A couple of Congresses ago, I chaired the Energy Subcommittee on Science, and I had an opportunity to hold a couple of hearings looking at the dimensions of the problem. It's surprising unanimity among the world's experts on how much is out there. There's about 1,000 gigabarrels of oil remaining in the world. We have 2% of those reserves. We use 20 million barrels a day. The rest of the world uses 60 million barrels a day. You divide that 80 million barrels a day into 1,000 gigabarrels. That's a trillion barrels. That sounds like a lot. But that lasts 40 years. But that's not 40 years of running along level and falling off the cliff. That's not 40 years of a straight downturn. That's following a bell curve. And so if we are, in fact, now at what's called Hubbert's Peak, or the Great Rollover, you can expect that oil production will be relatively constant for a couple of years or so, and then it will start down slowly and then very rapidly as you fall off of that bell curve. It's unlikely, sir, that there's a whole lot of reserves out there to be found. And the elasticity, you know, oil is now very much, gas is very much higher than it was before, and we aren't driving any less, sir. Mm-hmm. You know, there are certain demands for oil that have got to be met. I mean, you've got to have electricity, you know, you've got to run the trains, you've got to run your ships and so forth. Mm-hmm. And there's just not a whole lot of elasticity in that. And it would be really nice if the marketplace could take care of that. But I know you're addressing these questions. I'd be much appreciative if I could talk to your people who are concerned with this challenge.
We'll do it. Thank you very much, Congressman.
Thank you, sir.
I thank the gentleman. The gentlelady from Virginia, Ms. Drake.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank you, Mr. Secretary, and General Myers for being here with us today, and appreciate you returning to talk to us. And Mr. Secretary, in the time since you were here, I have had the benefit of listening to multiple combatant commanders testify since that February 16th meeting. I've read multiple analyses from CRS and CBSA, listened to multiple testimony, but it appears they're all prepared in a vacuum, and I think that's creating a frustration not only for me, but I've heard from other members of the committee. I've also read your responses to other questions from our colleagues here and on the Senate side as well. But that perception remains with us that the long-term reductions in shipbuilding, reducing the carrier fleet and the Virginia-class submarine were driven more by the budget than long-term strategic interest. Just this morning, General Magnus told us that he is concerned about our shipbuilding in the next 10 to 20 years. We've listened to Admiral Fallon describe his concerns surrounding the Taiwan Strait and China's vigorous efforts to match our fleet's capability. And we all realize the Navy is undergoing a very large-scale transformation, and we think that's good, that you're emphasizing readiness and moving towards a more mobile fleet with LSCs. But as China's fleet, as they continue to work to match our capability, I think that creates a tremendous amount of stress and concern for all of us as to whether we'll be able to match them in the future. And of course, with the wonderful work our U.S. servicemen have done in their tsunami efforts and just put a great face on us, I think it stresses we really need that presence around the globe. And I do know that Congressman Langevin has touched upon the issue, and you answered the question with a description of sea swap and increased deployability of our fleet. But still that perception's there, that the budget is driving everything, and I'm wondering how we get the information that we need, that we feel we've made the best strategic decisions, and we're making decisions based on what our military strength should be and not our budget.
There's never been a time in our country when there haven't been budgets. There always are budgets, there always will be budgets, and resources are finite. And somebody makes a decision in the executive branch as to what they want to propose, and then the Congress collectively acts on that and decides what they want to authorize and appropriate. And then the services task is to take that number and arrange the best possible, most capable force to fit the circumstances of the world then and prospectively. And so the answer to your question, I'm afraid, is there isn't ever going to be a time in our lifetimes when you'll have unconstrained budgets. We simply have to take the reality, the real world as we find it, and that's a world where resources are finite. Somebody decides that number, and then do our very best job with the services to propose to the Congress a balanced program that we believe will serve our country best today. And because the times are so long, these weapon systems go on 10, 20, 30 years, we have to try to look out, as you point out, with respect to China and other circumstances that can change dramatically in that period of time. I do think that it's very hard for me and for our allies overseas and for everyone, I think, to try to get into our heads that numbers are interesting, but they're not determinative. If you've got 10 bombs and they're dumb bombs, you've got 10 dumb bombs, and it takes 10 bombs to hit one target. If you've got 10 smart bombs, the same number, and they're going to hit the target, each one's going to hit the target. You don't have the same number of bombs. You've got a capability that's 10 times greater, even though the number of bombs are the same. And that is true with the capabilities of our aircraft. It's true with the ships. It's true with our troops. And it's so, I mean, we have a problem around the world. If we end up in country X and we have 40,000 troops, and they say, oh my goodness, you can't take 5,000 troops out because you'll weaken the deterrent. And yet the 40,000 troops have been there for 50 years, and the capability of those troops is five times what it used to be. We can very easily take them out without weakening the deterrent, except for the perception issue. And that's the problem. Now, there's one other issue besides perception, and that's presence. If you have a smaller number of ships, they, even though they may be twice as capable, and the aggregate lethality and capability of all of them will be vastly greater, even though it's a smaller number, they can't be in the same number of places. So presence is an issue. It is an enormously complicated problem. It's an important one. We worry about it. We think about it. And I've given you a too long an answer to a very good question.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentlelady, and we have a few members here who haven't had a chance to ask a question today. They got one a week ago, but I thought we might, since they've taken the time to be here, I thought we might let them have a chance here. And the gentleman from Mississippi, Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you very much, General Myers. And Secretary Rumsfeld for being here. Secretary Rumsfeld, I heard you say a few minutes ago, and I know you're just talking off the cuff, that we have 350 ships.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you
I
did.
Said, no, I did not. I said, if you had 400 ships, or if you and they were able to be out one-fifth of the time, and you had a lesser number, 350, I did not say we had 350, I did not say we had 400. It was a totally hypothetical example, and I used rounded numbers so that I could use percentages going from a fifth to a third.
Very good. Well, the real number is 288.
Of course.
And the fleet has shrunk by 10% on your watch. Now, I think it's fair to say that the ships, by and large, that you're using today that you have at your disposal came from previous Congresses and previous Secretaries of Defense. What does trouble me, in light of your statement that this country can spend what it needs to provide peace and stability in the world, what does trouble me is that the legacy of this year's budget will be a
Well, the what kind of budget?
The legacy of this year's budget, where you're only asking for four ships, presuming an ideal life of 30 years, is a 120-ship fleet. So question number one is, do you think that's the sort of legacy we ought to be leaving? Well, I'll say we, you as a Secretary of Defense and this Congress. Second question is, going back
to— Could I answer them one at a time?
Sure.
Good. And I'll try to be brief.
Sure.
And I'll bet you the chairman will let us run over if we have to. You're right on your math. But, of course, we're not proposing that same number of ships out. As Admiral Clark has testified, the number goes up and down from year to year. And to take one number and run it out and end up with a correct number, it seems to me, probably isn't right.
Is it also fair to say that you're not building this many, as many this year as you said you would this year?
If I recall,
last year's budget had you building eight this year. In reality, you're now only asking for four.
I don't have it in front of me, but I'm sure you're correct that the number this year is different. Now, one of the problems you know is that we fund the whole ship in a year, so you have big lumps, and a ship is not a ship. An aircraft carrier is one thing, a submarine is one thing, and a coastal frigate or something is an entirely different thing, and they cost a lot less.
Well, I'm also more than willing to work with you and very pleased to hear Secretary England talking about the willingness to go to multi-year funding. We ought to do that. Second question is, again, going back to your statement, we have to spend, we can spend what we need to provide peace. In January, 4,000 Mississippians went over to Iraq. The unit is the 155th. They trained in urban warfare, they trained in tunnels, they trained at the National Training Center, they trained for a long time at Camp Shelby. Prior to getting in theater, they did not.
I'm sorry, my ears are bad. I'm having trouble hearing.
Okay. If the chairman will indulge me, I will repeat myself. And
you said prior to something.
Okay. As you know, we just sent 4,000 Mississippians to Iraq. The unit is the 155th. They trained in tunnels. They trained in urban warfare. They trained at the National Training Center in deserts. What they did not spend one day training with were jammers. In the entire time that they were training to go to Iraq, they did not spend one day prior to getting in theater with jammers. As you and I both know, that over half the casualties are caused by IEDs. Mm-hmm. We both know that jammers have, in effect, a protective halo around them that is very much affected by the vehicle in front of you, the vehicle behind you, that each jammer has different capabilities. The jammers do interfere with our ability to communicate with each other. And to that point, have you set a date, a target, so that future units going into Iraq will have those jammers, be able to train with those jammers before they get in theater, since we know everyone is in agreement that over half of our casualties are being caused by this and that we can prevent many of those casualties?
I'd prefer to have General Myers. He's been wrestling with this along with the deputy, and it's an important subject. Do you want to respond, and then I'll add something?
You bet, Congressman Taylor. And let me just enlarge the problem just a little bit. I'm going to check on the 155th, because that they should understand what that kind of capability can bring to them. And so if they didn't get trained in that, that's just...
If I may, General Myers, it's actually a little worse than that. General Casey was good enough to come visit with us. He has not yet set a requirement towards that goal. Now, what he's saying is it is driven by the lack of jammers. If that's the problem, tell us what you need.
Right.
And I think we have actually allocated a heck of a lot of money, and I'm not so sure that it's being spent properly or has been spent as quickly as it should. And quite frankly, I'm beginning to see a bit of a Groundhog Day going on. First it was the body armor, then the up-armored Humvees, and now this. And I would like to see a sense of urgency coming from the Secretary's office, coming from your office, to fix this sooner.
Here's the problem. The problem is, as you correctly mentioned, improvised explosive devices are becoming a larger and larger threat. There are several ways to handle those, and the way we look at it is much the way we were told by our British counterparts, and maybe you've heard this when they were in Northern Ireland, where this same very similar threat was a problem, was that it's about, you solve it by about 60% of your tactics, techniques, and procedures. I'm confident the 155th was benefited from all the information in theater on how to tactically approach the problem. And so commanders on the ground have, and how they employ their forces is by far the way you deal with this kind of threat. The Brits also went on to say about 30% is technology, 10% luck. I don't like the luck piece. 30% technology is probably about right. It's not just jammers, it's other technologies. I'm sure you're aware of some. I'm not going to go into them in this open hearing, but there are other technologies we're using as well. Jammers are not a silver bullet to protect against IEDs, and you covered in your question, because we have a thinking adversary, and they move their capability around. And I'm just going to be happy to talk to you offline. So what we're doing, we know our requirement. General Casey has stated his requirement. We know the number of current systems that are required. It's not an issue of money. We have an IED task force that worries about, that's led by the Deputy Secretary of Defense, that worries about nothing but this, and it's not a money issue. Where we're putting a lot of our emphasis is try to get ahead of the problem and not behind the problem. We can produce jammers today that work the problem that we had yesterday, but will have no effect on the problem we're going to see around the corner, because we have a thinking adversary who moves their capability around. And I'll show you after the hearing, I can show you some where we're going. So what we're trying to do is get ahead of the problem in terms of the technology, specifically jammers, so we can deal with this. In the meantime, we are producing it, as my understanding is, because I've been pressing this the last several days, at the rate that the manufacturers can sustain right now, which is fueling them fairly rapidly.
Let me, if the gentleman will yield for a minute on this issue, because this is an important issue to the gentleman, but something I think would be appropriate at this time. We've been working, the committee's been working on a with the appropriators on supplemental to include monies for the expensive version of the jammers that we're turning out that has a fairly constrained production capability because of a number of factors, but we've put quite a bit of money into that, and the appropriators have marked that up at this point. But we've also developed a new capability that has been very promising, that's tested out, that finalizes up at Yuma in the next couple of days. And we've talked with the Secretary, the Undersecretary, Mr. Wolfowitz, and General Casey together, and we've got a provision to surge this capability into theater. And to use the new license that this committee wrote that says that the Secretary can waive all laws of the United States in acquisition to get the stuff as quickly as possible. So I want to tell my friend, my colleague, and the Secretary, and General Myers, that this is proceeding apace, and our thoughts are, and Mr. Secretary Wolfowitz has been very good on this, our thoughts are that we can use multiple producers of this capability, and it's a pretty simple system, and proliferate it in very rapid order. So we want to use this as our first model, really, of the new license that we've given the Secretary, up to $100 million to waive all laws in getting a battlefield requirement as quickly as possible. Right now, we think we've got that moving a pace, and we should have this thing up and running very quickly.
I've talked to General Casey about that after you talked to him. To get back to Congressman Taylor, in fiscal year 04 and 05, we spent over $300 million so far on jammers, with another over $400 million planned to be expended in 05. So this is not, it really isn't a question about money. It's a question about what we need to protect folks in the future and not build systems that protect for things that were attacking us last month or last year, because they're smarter than that and they move. So we've got to be smart too.
General, with all due respect, it's things that are killing Americans probably today and probably tomorrow and probably next week. We went through this with body armor. We went through this with the Humvees. At some point within the Pentagon, someone pointed at a calendar and said, we're going to fix the body armor problem by this date, and it got fixed. At some point, someone pointed to a calendar and said, we're going to fix the up-armored Humvee problem by this date, and it's almost fixed. What I'm asking is that we make the same sort of commitment on jammers, so that the next units aren't rotated into theater without having properly trained with this.
And that's our commitment.
That is my request.
You bet. That's our commitment. You bet.
I thank the gentleman. I want to engage the gentleman, too, as we move down the line with this production. The committee's going to be walking some factory production lines with our teams as this thing goes into production. The gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Saxton, also had a few questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and Secretary Rumsfeld, General Myers. Thank you for being here with us again. We appreciate it. My question has to do with the Aeronautical Defense Industrial Base. We've spent a lot of time today talking about what we're doing today, and you have both alluded in different answers to your concern about the future and how we deal with years as we look forward. This is a concern which has recently become a concern of mine, and I guess we should be able to look forward ahead, but sometimes things just happen to remind us of the importance of making plans for the future, and maybe we are, and if we are, I'd like to know how. When I was first elected to Congress, I went out to my hometown Air Force Base, McGuire Air Force Base, and I saw what sticks in my mind is about 60 C-141s sitting out there. And due to my total inexperience with acquisition, I looked at those airplanes and I never thought they might wear out. I came here and I remember sitting down where Jeff Davis is, and I started to hear about C-17. It was in its design phase at that time. And today, 20 years later, we have a fleet. It's a great airplane, produced, of course, out in neighboring city to Mr. Hunter, Long Beach. And then I've had more recently conversations with some fellows that fly F-15s and F-16s and F-18s, and all of a sudden recognized, hey, these airplanes are almost worn out. We've done something pretty good. We've produced the F-22 and are getting ready to produce the F-22 and the Joint Strike Fighter to replace those old birds. And here's my concern. It was proposed, or is proposed, I guess, to stop production of C-130Js, although your answer to a previous question today made me feel a little better. The C-17 is either going to stop at 180 or some higher number. I keep hearing 222 or 223. But even so, that line goes down at 223, somewhere around 2012 or 2013. And of course, then there's the issue of the tanker, which now I guess we're going to compete and with. We're going to have a competition, which I guess involves apparently foreign competition, presumably with a foreign company that's either subsidized or controlled by some other government. And when I look now talk for a minute about the bomber fleet. The B-1 is doing a great job, but I think we've modernized the fleet and reduced the fleet to 60 modern airplanes, which are doing a great job. And of course, we've got 21 B-2s. But just like that C-141 airplane, these airplanes aren't going to last forever. So here's my question. We're going to have a new bomber someday, and I know that the plans will be made to produce it. My concern is whether or not we're going to have an industrial base to do that job. And I'm just curious about what your thoughts are, same subject.
Well, let me start. It's amazing to me when I think back, when I was Secretary of Defense 30 years ago, the F-16 and the F-15 were just coming on. I approved the M-1 tank and the B-1 bomber, and I'm back and they're still there. It's amazing how long they last, and the B-52 preceded.
That proves you can get a lot of work out of some things.
That's right.
And those bombers.
The B-52, of course, preceded me, and it's still going strong. Now that weapon system. Now it's their new planes, and they have to be recapitalized. But all I can say is, you're right. If you want as the Congressman said about ships, same thing on aircraft. If you want a fleet of some number, and you don't buy some number each year, you're going to end up with a different size fleet. And the Air Force is going to need to be recapitalized. That's just the reality of it. They don't last forever. And partly it's the wear and tear on the aircraft, and partly it's the evolution of aircraft on the part of other countries, potential threats that evolve and improve in ways that force you to address it. And it's very, very expensive. The cost of these airplanes, I mean, that F/A-22, I think right now they're looking at something in excess of $250 million a plane. And so that's real money. My recollection is the F-16, when we were doing it 30 years ago, was something about $10 or $12 million an airplane. I guess I'm wrong. It's 100 and... Where is it? I can't see it. $257 million for an F&A at the moment. It depends on the number you buy. Dick, do you want to comment on it?
Well, the one thing about the bomber I know is that the Air Force is looking at that. I don't know if you want the specifics on that, but I know that the Air Force is looking very holistically at what might replace the B-1 or the B-2 in the future. On the industrial base, most of my knowledge there is in the space side of it, because when I was commander of U.S. Space Command, there was a study commission to look at the space industrial base. And then when I became the vice chairman, I think they reported out. And I remember at the time that was not a particularly satisfying picture, as our industrial base started to contract somewhat in our ability to produce the kind of systems in space that we thought we might need. And this includes the launch systems as well, not just the on-orbit assets, that was a concern. I have not studied the aircraft industry, so I can't comment and add anything to the debate at this point.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. This might be a good time, Ms. Secretary, just to make a comment on this. We're all familiar with the tanker saga. And my position is this. I don't care about personalities and the soap opera. The tankers and Boeing and all of the back and forth, particularly with the other body. I care about one thing. That's a requirement. Do we have a requirement for tankers? And number two, how do we meet it? We're just finishing a tanker sale. Boeing is to Japan and Italy. The Boeing, that's going to be the end of the line, and if there's no startup after that, it will be extremely expensive to restart that particular line. If we bring a foreign producer into this thing, we're going to have the set on a road in which conceivably we are sending a big piece of our industrial base overseas. In excess of 100,000 jobs, and I'm thinking about the how we start out all of these hearings, paying great, expressing our admiration of the people that carry the flag
of the United States in uniform around the world, and especially in these two warfighting theaters. These GIs and Marines and airmen and soldiers, lots of reservists, are going to be coming home. Some of those people could have some of those 100,000-plus jobs, high-paying jobs in aerospace. And the idea that we're going to contemplate giving those jobs to workers in France, which refuse to take the places that American soldiers are filling in these very difficult, dangerous warfighting theaters, and at the same time contributing to at least a potential stagnation of our aerospace industrial base that will leave us in a position where it's more difficult for us to produce the next generations of these species of aircraft that Mr. Saxton referred to. That doesn't make any sense. The idea that we would embark on that kind of a program. If the other body, the Senate, is worried about overpricing of tankers, why can't we take the blue book that's been established by the last couple of sales to Italy and Japan, or put together a blue ribbon panel of American businessmen who scrubbed the sale, scrubbed the proposed contract, and if they don't think that the contract is a fair one, that the price is a fair one, that it gives you enough of an economy of numbers below the rates that other countries are paying for the American tanker today, then they can come up with another recommendation. But I would just hope that that the idea of sending this work, this massive piece of high-paying work offshore, when we're going to have lots of GIs coming back that would like to have some of those jobs, along with the idea that it's that we can accept that kind of a chunk taken out of a very lean industrial base right now, I would hope that you wouldn't accept that, and that you would push back. And I can tell you from my perspective, and I don't know how many people will join with me, but I'm going to certainly push back on the idea of sending this work offshore. I think it's absolutely wrong. So I would hope that you don't contemplate that. And let me ask you, do you have some pretty serious people evaluating that piece of the question that Mr. Saxton pointed to? That is, what does it do to our industrial base and our capability of building these new species of aircraft in the future if we send this stuff offshore, these big pieces of work?
It's a, clearly your first choice is to recapitalize the force on a continuing basis so that you preserve your industrial base rather than fits and starts, which obviously are terribly difficult for industry to cope with. And with respect to the tanker, you correctly characterized where we are. The Congress had different views as to what should be done there, and there was the difficulty with Boeing. We're now in the process where there are, I think, two more studies that are being completed. One is the mobility study, a piece of it, and then there's a second one that is in the, I think it was the study of alternatives that's in its final stages. And the decision has been made that we will then compete it and see what happens. The Congress will have an important voice in it, and the executive branch will make recommendations. I don't know the timing on that. Do you offhand where we...
I do not know that, sir. No.
But both of you have raised a very important point, and it's a matter that we have to be attentive to.
As I recall, when we and I know we need to move on and let Ms. Davis ask her question, and so we'll get right to her. But as I recall, the final conference report on the tankers, the Senate had the competition requirement. I'd ask Mr. Rangel to correct me on this if I'm wrong, but the Senate had the competition requirement. And that requirement, that express requirement, was stricken in the conference. Is that right, Mr. Rangel? So if we struck the competition requirement in the conference, I hate to have a little fuss with the Senate here, and that was a Senate provision, How did we end up reinstating that in the ultimate result here?
There was the other issue in the Senate as between lease and buy, and that was a further factor that added complexity to the whole thing. I'd have to go back and reconstruct how we got from where you ended it to where we are today, but my recollection is that the general rule is to compete something. And we were criticized quite widely, of course, for different things by different people.
Yeah, but in this case, there was an impact that was a unique impact, because generally speaking, you have domestic competitors, and you do compete. But it's been a rare thing. In fact, I think almost unprecedented, where you've taken a program of that magnitude, and brought in a foreign competitor. And so, once again, when Congress works its will, and ultimately the bill is signed by the President, and you have a word in there that says it shall be competed, and it's stricken out in the conference, it's there, and then it's got an X through it, and the President signs the bill, that's a pretty strong positive manifestation that they didn't intend that word to be there. So I guess my question for our Senate, to you and our Senate brethren, would be, how did they manage to resurrect that word after they agreed to strike it out? But I know we need to have further conversations on that.
Good.
And the gentlelady, my good colleague from San Diego, has been waiting a long time, so the gentlelady is recognized.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I seem to be often in the last one to ask a question, and I know it's... If you pick up your things now, Mr. Secretary, I hope it won't be because of my question.
I wouldn't dare.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. It's good to see you. Good to see you, General
Thank
Myers,
you.
As well. I wanted to just very, very briefly go back to the issue of multi-year funding of our ships. I know that this is a big concern. We've had some informal discussions about that. Am I correct to hear you say that, at least from your point of view, that you would be working towards that end in the future?
I guess what I said, I believe, and that is that it is very difficult when you have a weapon system of that cost to fund the entire thing in a single year. It warps your program. And any way to blend that has attraction. It also has problems. And the problems, of course, from the Congress's standpoint, is that it mortgages your future. And so there's this tension and dilemma. The Office of Management and Budget has opinions on this. It is not something the Department of Defense can resolve unilaterally. And I can understand the pros and cons of doing it, but there are certainly pros in smoothing rather than having the big lump go through the snake.
I think we do understand there are certainly pros and cons. If you can err on the side of looking at it that way, that would be helpful. I think it's in the national interest. We need to look at readiness in that light. Two questions that are kind of cleanup questions. Well, one is a cleanup question, perhaps, on the supplemental. I wonder if you could speak to the 800 and I believe about $10 million that is being requested for support services, and that combat support services for the Iraqi military. We know how important combat support forces are to our military, and I'm wondering whether or not I heard correctly that this is kind of the last time that these dollars would be requested, and if that's true, how are we building the capacity, or how is the Iraqi Army, building the capacity so that need will essentially not be one that falls upon us?
I'd like to have the controller respond.
Thank you, Mrs. Davis. The $800 million, are you referring to contract services, the log cap?
$810 million, essentially, and 809.7.
To clarify, you're suggesting that you're asking whether or not this would be the last time we would use that mechanism?
My understanding was that would be the last request for combat support services.
Okay.
And perhaps that that has been misrepresented. But what I'm looking for is how actually could that be true, and how would you anticipate that we would plan for that eventuality as well?
Certainly.
How long would it take?
Let me just clarify, and I'll have to get back to you for the record. I'll talk with the appropriate people on that. In the $5.7 billion that we are requesting for the Iraqi security forces, we have $809 million in for logistical support. So I would presume, I mean, we'll need to work with CENTCOM and figure out where they are with that requirement, but that should be sufficient for this year.
And that should be sufficient
for this cycle. I do not know. I'll have to get back to you for the record to find out whether they're going to need.
I guess the question would be how we're doing in building the capacity for them to be able to move on with those functions, because that is a separate function from other functions in terms of building the military.
And maybe I'll defer to Chairman Myers on that question on their capacity.
You're exactly right, and the Secretary's been pressing this for some time, and that is to, as we build Iraqi security force capacity and capability, in this case, it's, I think, mainly logistics and intelligence that it's going to support, that at some point, the Iraqis have to take that over. They have to plan, program, and budget for that. And we are working with the Ministry of Defense, the Minister of Interior, the Prime Minister on this issue. As you know, they're going to go through a change in government, so we're going to have to continue to work with the Iraqis so they can start programming and budgeting, so we can dig out of the business, and that's the plan. I don't know what 06 portends yet. I don't think we haven't rounded that corner yet, but I know the Secretary is pressing this very hard. That first of all, you don't create a force that is unsustainable by the host nation, in this case Iraq or Afghanistan, and second, that we don't do it any longer than we have to do it. That this is their business. They have resources, and they can get about it.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And if I may, very quickly, in the Army Reserve Supplemental Request, it's my understanding that they asked for $62 million, got $8.1 million. Some of what was not included in that are the dollars that would be needed for recruiting. And the other thing is, which is of great concern to me, is the family support services for family programs. As you know, the reserve families who are part of the reserve are not able to access the active duty support services. And so in many ways, I suspect for most of my colleagues, a lot of our case management right now is to those families. So I'm wondering why perhaps those dollars have been cut out of the supplemental.
If there is in any service that needs additional funds for recruiting and retention, there will be a reprogramming to take care of that. We simply have to do that. Mm-hmm. And I'd be surprised if there is a shortfall, but there won't be. As the year goes along, you can be sure there would be a reprogramming that would take care of that. I agree with you on the family support. I don't know the specific reference you're making, but that is something that is just enormously important. It's important for the active force, to be sure, but the active force tends to be located together and tends to have a support system, whereas the Guard and Reserve may come from three, four different states. They don't have that kind of a support system, and we simply have to do everything humanly possible to see that we provide that in a way that makes sense, and it is something that's very high on our priority list.
Thank you. I hope we can work to be sure that if they need those dollars, that they're there. Thank you.
I thank the gentlelady. The gentleman from Kansas, Mr. Ryan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, let me thank General Myers for being here, and Secretary Rumsfeld. I know you've had a long day, but thank you very much for being here for our questions. I have actually two. I'll begin with the first one. So with regard to Army transformation and global repositioning, I know those are top priorities in the coming years. As part of this, it's my understanding that the Army has two divisions that will be returning from Germany at some point. Could you shed some light on sort of the timeline that you're looking at with those divisions coming back?
I can't. And the reason is twofold. We're moving forces from throughout the world, and as you point out, in Europe, I recall it's some, we plan on being about 70,000 and 100,000, 70,000 troops, 100,000 dependents home, back to the United States of America from Europe. The pace at which it will be done will be a function of a set of negotiations that are now in their early stages, varying stages, I should say, well along in Korea, for example, less well along in some other parts of the world, as to how we will move out and where we will go. And the advantage we have, big advantage, is that fortunately we got ahead of the curve on the global posture changes, ahead of BRAC. And therefore, the number of bases that might be closed or adjusted downward in some way will be considerably fewer, because we already have solved the problem of what we're going to bring back. And but where they will go and what the timing will be, the second factor is a simple one, and it's money. There are some funds in BRAC, but then there's also military construction funds. And what we'll have to do is to ask ourselves, what do we ultimately decide, Congress and the executive branch, that we're going to have to close, and therefore what will we be moving around, and what will it cost, and how much of it do we want to eat each year? How fast do we want to do it? There's advantages to speed, reduced force protection costs, and fewer permanent changes of station, less disruption on lives. There's a lot of advantages to doing it fast. And the disadvantage, obviously, is that in movements like this, the cost is up front and the savings lag. And so until we can work with you all in the Congress to decide what that pace ought to be, we can't answer the question, except my instinct always is let's do it faster rather than slower.
So if I may sort of rephrase the question, you're not necessarily changing the strategy to being back two divisions. It's just the timeline is something that can't be determined at this point.
Oh, we're not changing the strategy at all.
That was one thing I wanted to clarify. If I may go to a second brief question in regard to North Korea and about its nuclear capabilities, a reminder that they have ballistic missile and weapons of mass destruction threat to the United States that are real and growing. In light of this evolving threat environment, what is your outlook for the development of global missile defense system to address perhaps the problem or the threat we might have with North Korea?
We have, needless to say, a budget for ballistic missile defense. It is down slightly from what we had last year projected, along with some other items, as was pointed out earlier. The technology has been being worked on. It is consistently getting better and being improved. It is leading edge technology. And we had a couple of instances that General Myers can comment on recently where we didn't have failures, but we did not have a launch because of a, I guess it was a micro switch that didn't allow.
Actually, that's changed, sir. It was a micro switch, they thought. Now they think the actual arm did not retract for whatever reason. They were both silo-based problems. One was in the computer program, and one was perhaps in the hardware. So.
And on the other hand, we just had the successful ship-based launch.
Correct, of the Standard 3 missile.
And we are anticipating that we will have a early, modest ballistic missile defense capability deployed this year. And then it will have been tested out. And on the other hand, it will still be in the early stages. It will still be in a developmental stage, if you will. That's not unusual. If you think of our Predator weapon system, it was developmental, and we've been using it extensively, and it's been doing a very good job for us. So it's not the first time we would be mixing something that was developmental and actually using it on a battlefield.
Well, let me just close by saying I want to say appreciation to not only what you're doing, but what General Myers is doing for your leadership and what you have done to help our country. And I return my time back to the chairman.
Well,
I thank you,
the gentleman and Ms. Secretary. Our last person to be recognized here is the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Conaway, a new member of the committee who's got lots of troops in his district.
We're right up close and personal down
exactly.
here.
Exactly, exactly. Well, the highlight so far of serving on this committee is being eyeball to eyeball with you and General Myers for this time frame. I will not ask any questions at the risk of replowing ground that's you've been at it 2.5 hours, but I would like to make one comment. Monday I spent some time out at Bethesda visiting young Marines who have been injured in Iraq. Some of those injuries so severe that their lives as they knew them have been changed and altered. Each one of those young men, proud to do their duty, proud to have served their country, but they were also surrounded by moms and dads and wives and brothers and sisters who, through the Marine Corps process of shepherding these young men through that transition, were there to help. Were there to give the comfort that that they needed. A real, in my mind, a real sensitivity to that entire process. And you know, I came away from it saying, well, yeah, we do take care of our own. And if we do have some shortcomings, and those are pointed out, we move heaven and earth to fix that. But in this instance, it sure appeared that that we were taking care of those young men. And what a wonderful responsibility you and General Myers have to lead this Defense Department. An incredible core of dedicated professionals that defend this country. I just can't imagine how much pride you must have in doing that, and thank you for the job you do. Mr. Chairman, with that, I'll yield back the remainder of the time.
Well, thank you very much, Congressman. None of us ever leave those hospitals except coming out inspired at the courage and the professionalism and the pride that those young men and women feel in what they're doing, and in the strength of their families. It's just wonderful to meet the families and the support they're given. What we've got to do is make sure that as they leave there and go back into the community in one way or another. Fortunately, we're able to keep a lot of them in the military, even with severe wounds. One of them with a leg went off, and he's gone through jump school and is back on duty. But those that do leave the service then go into a different environment, and we're going to have to work very closely with the Veterans Administration to make sure that their circumstance as they leave is supported by a operations center that's been set up very recently. It's called a Military Severely Injured Joint Support Operations Center that will supplement the work that's being done by the services. But I thank you very much for your comments, and I appreciate it.
It's probably worth noting again that there's an Army captain who was wounded in 2003 in Iraq, lost a foot, and he's rejoined his unit. And my understanding, he's back in Iraq now by choice to go back with his unit.
Well, if I could add two to that, we had a personnel committee hearing the other day, and we had a young airman who lost a foot in Afghanistan. He is now back on active duty with the Air Force Security Corps and has run a marathon. Young Marine Sergeant, maybe the same one you and I are talking about, lost a left foot. He went to jump school. Mm-hmm. They made him requalify. He qualified. They got to jump school. They didn't believe him. They made him do it again. Finished first in his class.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So incredibly inspiring young men, and I suspect young women as well throughout this entire Corps.
You
so
bet. You're right about it. There are some women that have been severely injured, and they're just as inspiring.
My wife just came back from Vail, Colorado, with 20 wounded who were skiing with legs off and arms off, and one was blind. I think it was 20, and I think two of them were women. You're quite right. There are women as well as young men. And the town of Vail, the merchants, the ski valley, whatever it is, the corporation, instructors, clothing stores, all turned out. Excuse me, and provided just a wonderful time for these young folks. It was just spectacular. Excuse me.
I thank the gentleman, and I know the ranking member had some closing comments.
Well, let me thank you again, Mr. Secretary and General, for being with us again. Appreciate it. I've already spoken to General Myers about this, but Mr. Secretary, let me put this on your screen, if I may. And as the good book says, think on these things. I'm very concerned about what we call professional military education, and in many respects, I won't go into any detail right now, but merely to point out there may be some instructional and student and mix challenges. I also know that the Command General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth will graduate some in April so they can take billets in the active, and I also understand that a good number of the Army Senior War College at Carlisle will allow some to leave at the halfway point with the promise that they may come back later and finish their work at the Army War College. I just want you to put this on your screen, because we intend to take a good look at it and at some point have a serious discussion with you about it. And I thank General Myers for coming to my office and visiting with me about it the other day. Several of us, Mr. Klein included, who, by the way, is a graduate of the Army War College, are concerned, and we'd like to pursue this at a later date. But I'll just put that on your screen, Mr. Secretary.
Yes, sir. General Myers and I have been talking about it, and Dr. Chu and the services. It's an important question, and we sure want to do it right. Thank you, sir.
Well, Mr. Secretary, General Myers and Ms. Jonas, thank you very much for being with us. We have a lot of challenges ahead. Ms. Secretary, you're reshaping the military, and you've got a couple of hot wars and a global war on terrorism, and in my judgment, the country's very fortunate to have you at the helm right now. We look forward to working with you. I hope you especially help us walk through this new rapid acquisition capability that we've now have at your disposal, especially with these new force protection measures that we're taking out of the box right now. So we'll go to work with you. Thank you very much for coming with us and today, being with us today, and staying until the very last member got his question answered. We appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
And the hearing's adjourned.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
This morning on Washington Journal, we'll announce the winners of C-SPAN's Abraham Lincoln Essay Contest.